heard there was a secret chord David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major live, the baffled king composing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
I'm Lauren.
I am Ken.
And this is Paradise After Dark. Paradise After Dark is a bi-weekly podcast covering true crime,
unsolved mysteries,
missing people,
urban legends, and the dark side of the Sunshine State. You can check out our website at paradiseafterdark.com for our latest episodes, links to social media, our Etsy store, and a special little donate button if you just want to help out the show.
If you have a question, a Florida case suggestion, or you just like to chat, please email us at paradiseafterdarkpodcast@gmail.com.
So Lauren, won't you start us off here and tell us a little bit about what we're talking about tonight and maybe that intro?
Tonight we are going to start telling you the story of Taylor McAllister. So this is not just a story about Taylor. This is a story about her murder, the likely culprits who have not been charged, a bumbled investigation, and up to this point, what I believe to be a complete miscarriage of justice. Will there ever be justice for Taylor and her family? That's my question. That's one of the reasons we chose to cover this story. And this can be confusing, so please pay attention as we go along. This is going to be a three-part series, and part three of this series will include a candid interview with Taylor's parents, who tell us their side of the story and what they've gone through. And you'll notice that we've replaced our regular intro music with Taylor's voice. We are lucky enough to have these clips of her beautifully singing. And just a side note, all parties are innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. So, moving along. Taylor McAllister was born in Melbourne, Florida on July 21st, 1994 to Bill and Leslie McAllister. At age 22, she was living in St. Petersburg, Florida. She was married to a man named Joshua and was the mother of 18-month-old twin girls. Taylor had an enormous passion for music and loved to sing and play guitar. There are beautiful videos of her on Facebook, playing guitar and singing. She loved the beach, being out on the boat, watching the dolphins, and just spending time with her family and her girls. According to her father, Bill McAllister, Taylor was everything music. She taught herself to play guitar around age 14 and played nonstop. She would sit and record herself all the time and come running out of her room whenever she learned a new song. She was an old soul and loved anything vintage. She would make her own outfits and clothing. She used to do all her friends' hair and makeup for homecoming and prom. Taylor would sit and watch SpongeBob with her younger sisters, and she could quote any movie. There was never a person that met her that didn't fall instantly in love with her. Her personality was infectious, and she loved everyone. She had this way with people. She just drew them in. She would meet you one time, and the next time she saw you would give you the biggest hug as if she'd known you her whole life. Bill describes Taylor as a young woman who always treated people kindly and wanted to do right by people. She liked to help people even when she was little. In high school, she would ask her parents all the time during the day if a friend could come stay at our house because they were having a family problem at home or needed a place to stay. She was just kind-hearted like that.
Sounds like somebody you'd want to be friends with.
Right.
Yeah. So, heartbreakingly, on the morning of December 22nd, 2016, the police were dispatched to a dirt alley in a residential neighborhood in St. Petersburg in reference to a female body there. Nathaniel Oliver Jr., a retired St. Petersburg Sanitation Department worker, picks up cans in his spare times for recycling, and that's what he was doing on that morning around 6 a.m. when he found Taylor's body. He said that he went to his neighbor's house and told him he had a body laying in the alley behind this house, and then he called police.
So, the body that was found, The victim was located in the alley behind 63rd Avenue South in St. Petersburg.
Now, this alley is, it's like a main road. It's like a dead end street. And where it dead ends, there's like a pathway between that dead end cul-de-sac and another street that passes through.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a dead end little alleyway.
Along the south side of the alley, there are different fences and gates to the homes, which face 63rd Avenue South. On the north side of the alley, there is an approximately 5-foot chain link fence with brush that puts a divider between the alley and the Bay Point Villa apartments. The head of the victim was facing east with her legs facing west. She was observed with only a gray t-shirt on that was pulled up to her neck. Both the victim's arms were laying by her side. Her left leg was slightly bent and her right leg was straight out. There were tire marks on her left arm and leg.
Tire marks?
Yes. Now remember this detail. It did not appear that lividity had set in yet. Her eyes were closed and her mouth was slightly open. There were ants covering parts of her body. There was what appeared to be bruising around her vagina and her wrists.
Officer Samora Church documented the girl's tattoos and attempted to identify her that way in SOPICS. This is Florida Sheriff's Consolidated Mugshot and Facial Recognition System. After researching the name tattoos on her upper left arm, Charlie Ann and Madison May, they were able to positively identify the deceased as Taylor Ann McAllister.
So first, I think we need to understand how Taylor ended up in that alley, because it was not random.
No.
We spoke to Taylor's father, Bill, and he gave us this explanation. Taylor started using drugs recreationally around the age of 18. When she married Joshua in 2013, she moved with him to Seattle, where apparently she started using again. Joshua was using drugs as well. When she got pregnant with her twins, Joshua, who was in the Coast Guard, was scheduled to deploy overseas for a year, so she moved back home with her parents. She was clean during her whole pregnancy, but because she had a C-section, she was prescribed pain pills, which started a whole new addiction.
Ouch.
It spiraled from there to harder drugs, but mainly pain pills. Bill and Leslie did everything they could to try and help Taylor get clean. They tried putting her in detox, rehabs, and even sending her away to get clean. They tried tough love and had her on an almost lockdown status at their home. She stayed clean for about 6 months under these conditions.
Yeah, and we spoke about this several times, that the opioid addiction, and I think there's a new documentary out that talks about it. That's a rough one. That's a rough challenge to overcome. Well, in August of 2016, Taylor ended up leaving her parents' house and began staying with a friend in Palm Harbor. This is a town just a little north of St. Petersburg. And this is when, according to the witnesses interviewed in the police reports, that Taylor's drug use got worse. She also began advertising herself on Backpage as an escort. Now, according to one witness who was interviewed, Taylor's husband, Joshua, was the one who created the Backpage account, and he was sending Taylor out on escort jobs. And Taylor told her friend that the decision was mutual and that Joshua was not making her do anything she didn't want to do. And in 2015, around Thanksgiving, Taylor's husband went to rehab, but Taylor still continued to use drugs and she still advertised herself on Backpage. Now, during this time, through Backpage, Taylor met a man, 52-year-old Robert Butler III. Now, Robert Butler III is the heir to a local flooring company in St. Pete. It's Bob's Carpet Mart and Flooring. Now, this is a successful flooring company which opened in 1969 and now includes more than a dozen stores in the western side of Florida. He lived in the upscale neighborhood of Cobb's Landing in Palm Harbor, and Butler had a checkered past filled with legal troubles, including drugs and violence. And in 1992, he was convicted of aggravated assault with a firearm in a domestic violence incident involving his ex-wife. He had multiple drug convictions over the years, another battery conviction in 2007. He'd even had an arrest for urinating in public on a table in a restaurant. Now, one of his most recent charges, aside from the charges related to Taylor, which we'll get to later, stem from his drug habit. He was charged with being in a money laundering scheme and paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to his drug dealer, Deontay Baker, for cocaine and marijuana. He usually bought his drugs with checks. Now, the records show writing out some of the checks to the girlfriend of the dealer from March 2013 to April of 2016, in a system prosecutors said was meant to conceal and disguise the nature of the transactions. I guess that's so that way it didn't look like he was just buying cocaine from a coke dealer.
With a check.
Exactly. So probably on payroll or something to that effect. In June of 2016, the plea agreement says Butler began writing checks to his to the girlfriends, eventually totaling $140,490. Now, Baker, the accused dealer, also faces federal drug charges.
After meeting Taylor, according to her family, Butler became obsessed with her. He moved her into his home, supplying her with money and drugs, and formed a type of, quote, sugar daddy relationship with her. In a statement to police, Taylor's husband Joshua even admitted that Taylor was living with Butler, who he referred to as Birdie, because he did not know Butler's real name. He told police that Birdie was heavy into drugs too, and even had a drug dealer living with him. Joshua also said that Taylor told him she was scared of Birdie. He stated that she had made plans to leave Birdie several times but never followed through. He also told police about Taylor's drug addiction and advised them that she used a drug dealer named Smiley.
Well, when Taylor's body was found, Officer Paul Hines of the St. Petersburg Police Department canvassed the entire neighborhood. And Officer Hines went to every home on the street and in the surrounding neighborhood, including an apartment complex that the back is sort of butted up to the alley where Taylor was found. Now, most people that Officer Hines spoke to in the neighborhood didn't hear or see anything except a woman named Jeanette. Jeanette stated that she woke up when she heard a loud screaming noise coming from a woman and a truck engine from outside. This was around 3:30 a.m., but she wasn't sure exactly what time it was. She went back to sleep and woke up again around 4:15 when she heard the screaming again. And Jeanette also stated that she poked her head out of the front door but didn't see anything.
Officer Brian Santiago also canvassed the neighborhood and had better luck than Hines. A neighbor named Tacoa stated that she did not hear any noise in the alley, however advised that prior to police arrival, she was standing outside of the residence and observed a white male with a stocky build, approximately 6 foot tall to 6 foot two, weighing 200 to 225 pounds, wearing dark colored shorts with yellow and blue trim, walking east from the alley. She further advised that the male was carrying what appeared to be a black female clutch wallet. Neighbor Joyce advised the same as Tacoa that she did not hear any noise in the alley, however advised that prior to police's arrival, she was standing outside of the residence and observed the same white male, same description, wearing dark colored shorts with yellow and blue trim, walking east from the alley. She further advised that the male was carrying what appeared to be a black female wallet clutch, and she'd never seen him in the area before.
So you got two witnesses giving the same description of the person.
Of the same person, yes.
Exactly, carrying the same exact identical. Okay.
So neighbor Ernest told Officer Santiago that he was awake between the hours of 1 a.m. and 5 a.m. He stated that he was watching television and heard screaming coming from the direction of the alley between the hours of 1:30 and 2 a.m. He said that the screaming lasted about 5 to 6 minutes. He also heard the sound of vehicle doors slamming. He further stated that he stepped outside because he believed that his vehicle was being burglarized. He stepped to the front of the residence, however, did not proceed any further and returned inside. Many residents advised the officers that the alley was well trafficked by people in the area, both from the apartment complex and the surrounding homes.
Yeah, that's like I said, because it's the way it is. It's like a dead end street, and this is like a little cut through to get to a main alleyway.
Yeah, it's not like a secluded alleyway or anything
exactly.
Like that. It's pretty open.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a dead end, but if you wanted to get from one street to the other, you kind of cut through this cul-de-sac dead end.
Yep.
So that's why, you know, when they hear weird noises or odd noises out there, it's something they're used to all the time. Maybe not so much the screaming and whatnot. But now, after speaking with Taylor's husband and learning of her sugar daddy, Robert Butler, a.k.a. Birdie, they responded to Butler's home in Palm Harbor. Butler stated that he has known Taylor for a few months. He advised that he saw her Backpage escort advertisement and arranged a meeting where he paid her for sex. He stated that she comes over to the house a lot for sex, but she did not live there. He advised that he had not seen or heard from her since Saturday, December 17th of that year, 2016. Now, this was 5 days before her body was found. He stated that he knew Taylor used drugs a lot, primarily crack cocaine and Dilaudid. He stated that he sometimes smokes marijuana and crack cocaine, but keeps it under control. He also stated they rarely use drugs together, and they did not take any drugs on the previous Saturday night. I guess they did when the last time they seen each other, they didn't do drugs together. He advised a drug dealer known as Smiley, which we mentioned earlier, had delivered pills to Taylor at his house in the past. Butler claimed he did not know Smiley's real name or even how to contact him. He just knew of him.
Well, before we go any further, let's get a word from our sponsors that keep this show free for our listeners. This wasn't the only time Smiley was mentioned. On December 26, 2016, investigators were contacted by Tomasita Petru, a friend of Taylor's. She stated that she and Taylor had set up an Instagram account together, and she was on it the night before. Someone contacted her on that account and asked who she was and asked her to call him. Petru ended up talking to the subject, who identified himself as Smiley. He asked her what the autopsy had said about Taylor. He told her about a guy named Bert that Taylor was staying with. He said that whatever happened, Bert knew about it or had something to do with it. He asked if the police had any of Taylor's belongings and stated that all of her belongings should be at Bert's house, and if they're not, he got rid of them.
Smiley turned out to be a drug dealer named Pasquale Smiley. Now, although when interviewed by police, he stated he did not sell drugs to Taylor, he did state, however, he was helping Taylor's husband, Joshua, get clean. He knew Taylor was staying with Butler, and they were using a lot of drugs. But Smiley stated Butler was very controlling, and McAllister had told him Butler flipped out on her once in the truck.
Another important person who was interviewed was one of Taylor's friends, Julie Gazvada. Gazvada told investigators that she met Taylor and her husband through a friend named Tracy Such. She and Tracy became very close. Gazvada advised Taylor and Joshua had a drug habit that got progressively worse during their relationship. She said she eventually took Taylor under her wing with Backpage to keep others from taking advantage of her. She stated Taylor was fearless and wouldn't back down from anyone. She advised she eventually got Taylor to enter rehab during the spring of 2016. But Gazvada was arrested in May of 2016 and spent several months in the Pinellas County Jail. While in jail, Smiley told her Taylor had relapsed and was working on Backpage again. She got out of jail in October 2016 and started hanging out with Taylor and Joshua again. She said Taylor and Smiley helped her get back on her feet after being in jail. Taylor had already started seeing Birdie by this time, and it wasn't sexual at first. She stated she would just hang out with Birdie and do drugs. She advised Birdie would give Taylor money and drugs anytime she needed it. Gazvada told police Birdie became increasingly jealous of her relationship with Taylor and began limiting contact. Taylor eventually decided to move in with Birdie at the beginning of November, at which time the sexual relationship began. She advised Taylor only did it for the drugs, but Birdie thought they were in love and he acted like he owned Taylor. She stated Taylor stopped doing Backpage dates after moving in with Birdie. Gazvada stated Birdie was extremely possessive of Taylor and rarely let her out of his sight. Eventually, Taylor wasn't allowed to leave and visit with Gazvada on her own. Gazvada began seeing a drastic change in Taylor's demeanor. She stated Taylor seemed scared to upset Birdie and in fear of him. Gazvada stated eventually she was only able to see Taylor by tagging along with Smiley when he delivered drugs to Birdie's house. She stated she would ask to use the bathroom while Smiley and Birdie did the deal in the driveway. She would try to get Taylor to leave with them, but she never got her away from Birdie. She stated Taylor and Birdie lived like hermits and rarely left the house.
So they would just stay there all the time to what people would believe just do drugs.
Yes.
So they would just stay there or hang out. Maybe they just didn't leave anyway. So it wasn't like she was a social butterfly to get around at this point in her life.
Right.
So this is like a total change from the wonderful
the
person
outgoing,
she exactly.
Yes.
So it's you can see where the drugs have taken her to this point.
Right.
Now, back to Butler, aka Birdie, aka Bert. Now, Butler told police that on December 21st, he woke up between 9 to 10 a.m. and didn't leave his house all day. Now, he stated that his friend Deontay Baker had come around 11 a.m. and borrowed his truck. Now, this is a white Toyota Tundra. Now, during the interview, officers observed Butler to have several minor scratches that appeared to have occurred in the last couple days. So these are fresh wounds. Now, these two scratches were just above his forehead. He also had scratches on the bridge of his nose and both forearms. Butler also had an apparent fresh bruise on his right rear shoulder blade. Now, they requested that Butler provide a DNA sample from a buccal swab, at which time he asked if he could speak with his attorney. Now, Butler advised that his attorney, Kevin Hazlett, was currently representing him on a recent DUI case. Now, anyone who knows, Kevin Hazlett is a big-time lawyer up there in that area in St. Pete, Tampa. Now, Butler spoke to his attorney privately, then put the phone down on speaker, at which time Hazlett advised that his client was not going to provide any DNA samples and requested that he terminate the interview.
So on December 23, 2016, Deontay Baker voluntarily responded to the police station to be interviewed. They showed Baker a picture of Robert Butler, and he identified him as Bert. Baker was shown a photograph of the victim, Taylor McAllister, and identified her as Taylor. He stated that he was living at the house with Butler and Taylor, but recently he'd been staying away because they were bringing people into the house that he didn't trust. Now let's remember that Baker is Butler's live-in drug dealer.
Yeah, this is where things start getting confusing, so you really want to pay attention because Butler is the person she was living with. Baker's the dealer.
Right.
Okay.
So Baker stated that Butler met Taylor through Backpage and she had been living at the house for a couple months. He stated that he frequently brought drugs, crack cocaine, and marijuana to the house for Butler and Taylor to use. He also stated that Taylor also used Dilaudid, but he didn't have access to that drug. He stated that she was having other dealers bring it to the house. He stated that his girlfriend, Khadijah Hunt, stays with him at Butler's house. Now, Butler gave several inconsistent accounts of his movements from the time he woke up on December 21st, 2016, until he visited Butler on December 22nd, 2016. After being questioned about the inconsistencies, Baker stated that he didn't remember anything from the afternoon of the 21st until going up to Butler's around 11 a.m. on the 22nd. He advised that Coron Archer drove him up around 11 a.m. on December 22nd to pick up Butler's truck. He advised they were originally going to buy a couple bikes from Walmart for Christmas presents. He stated that Coron was complaining about the dog smell in the truck, so they changed their plans and dropped the truck off at the car wash. He said they didn't pick up the truck until around 6 p.m., then headed back to Butler's house. When they got back to Butler's home, Butler told them the police had been there and he told them about Taylor's death.
Okay, now, Kieran Archer came in and voluntarily came into the station. He did an interview. And he stated at this time that he met Butler through Baker about 3 or 4 months prior to all this. Now, he stated that he has been friends with Baker for 6 to 7 years, has been driving him for 3 or 4 months. He drives Baker and his girlfriend around in one of Baker's cars. Now, apparently, these drug dealers now have their own personal drivers.
I guess so.
So you do the right things, you can get
certain
drugs.
So Archer is Baker's driver.
Yep.
Okay.
Baker's the dealer, Archer's the driver,
Butler's the old white guy with all the money.
With all the money who Taylor was living with.
Butler, aka Bert, aka Bertie.
Okay. It gets confusing, so please, like we said, hang in here. He stated that he has seen Taylor at Butler's house a few times, but doesn't really know her. Now, unlike Baker, Archer gave a very detailed account of what he did on December 21st and 22nd. Now, I'm going to get into this, so follow along. This is going to get confusing, so I'll try to just put it together here real quick. Now, he woke up at 7:30 on December 21st. He gave a friend a ride to work, then went to his mother's house for 3 to 4 hours. Then he went and picked up Baker at the Comfort Inn, and they brought food to one of Baker's girlfriends, Khadijah Hunt, at her job, and dropped him off at another friend's house, who is Miriam Humphreys. Now, Archer stated that he took a nap until 5 p.m., then went to pick up Taisha from work. He said they picked up her daughter from school and dropped her off at their house. He drove up to Bethel Heights Apartments to hang out with some friends.
Then back to Hunt's salon around 9 p.m. and met up with Baker. At approximately 10:30 p.m., he and Baker followed Hunt back to the Comfort Inn. He stated that he and Baker picked up McDonald's while Hunt registered for the room. He advised that he met Baker and Hunt at the hotel room around midnight and went back to his apartment. Baker called him around 1:15 a.m. and had him drive him to a woman's house named Tashana.
Archer stated that he left Baker there and went back to his apartment. Baker called him again around 2:40 a.m. and had him drive him back to the Comfort Inn. Archer advised that he went back to Bethel Heights, but only stayed there for a little bit because there was no one out there. He then was back at the apartment by 4 a.m. and went back to bed. And on December 22nd, Archer stated that he woke up at 7 a.m. and left to pick up Taisha at 7:30. He advised that he took her child to school and then took Taisha to work. Now, Archer stated he got back to Bethel Heights again around 9:30 a.m. and hung out with friends until about 11. Archer stated that Baker called him and wanted to go Christmas shopping, so he picked up Baker from the Comfort Inn, and this was around 11:20, and they went straight to Butler's house. He stated they stayed at Butler's house for about 20 minutes and only saw Butler and his dog. That's all they seen. They didn't see any signs of Taylor. Now, Archer stated that he drove Humphrey's Challenger and Baker drove Butler's truck when they left the house. He stated that they stopped at the apartment complex near Gandy Boulevard and left the Challenger there. Archer advised that they both took the truck to the Walmart in South St. Petersburg and bought two girls' bicycles and took them to Tashana's grandmother's house in Child's Park.
Okay, real quick, because we keep talking about Taisha. Taisha is another one of Deontay Baker's girlfriends.
Yeah, we talked about the girlfriends earlier.
Okay, so so far we have Khadijah Hunt, Taisha Petit, and Miriam Humphreys. I'm just making sure that this is all clear.
Okay.
Okay, keep going.
Now, he then drove Baker to Walgreens, at which time Baker left with an unknown girl at around 3 p.m. Archer stated that he took the truck to the car wash at Central Avenue and 28th Street to get it detailed. Archer advised that Khadijah Hunt picked him up in the Mercedes and brought him to her salon. So she works at a salon. She drives a Mercedes. Got that. Archer advised that he left Hunt at the salon and drove the Mercedes to Bethel Heights, where he stayed from 4:15 to 5 p.m. He then had to go to pick up Taisha at work and her child from school. He and Baker eventually picked up the truck, at which time they went up to Butler's house to return the truck. Coach Anthony Sullivan, Taisha, and her child went to Butler's too, and they were all there, and they hung out for a little while. He stated that he and Coach left in the truck, and Baker and Taisha and the child left in the Challenger. Yeah, maybe too many details.
Yeah.
So when there's too many details, how do you feel about that? Do you feel like it's almost rehearsed, or like he's thought of it so many times? He's told himself the stories. Okay, I got to say this. I was here.
I don't know.
Do you feel like that?
Too many details always makes me feel a little funny.
Yeah, I feel suspicious about the details.
Yes.
So if you didn't catch all that, please rewind. Hit that 15 seconds.
You don't
back.
Need to rewind, really, because it's just a whole bunch of
here, there. So he's basically given a description of where he is.
He's giving a minute-by-minute account of every single thing he did for 48 hours.
And in all my years, I've only met three or four people that can do that.
I can't do that. I can't even tell you what I did this afternoon.
I can do it, but not the next day. So I can tell you what I did all day that day, but not the next day. So
during the course of the investigation, authorities interviewed Miriam Humphreys. Now, Miriam, as I just mentioned a minute ago, was one of Deontay Baker's other girlfriends. Miriam owns a BMW and a white Dodge Challenger, which he lets Deontay Baker and his driver, Archer, drive. She told authorities that on the morning of December 22nd, she drove her BMW to Robert Butler's house to clean. This was not unusual, as she cleaned his home every month or so. Now, Miriam stated that an older black man named Coach, which we found out earlier is Anthony Sullivan, was there when she arrived and he was cleaning the house already. Miriam stated it was not normal for Coach to help her clean, but he does do odds and ends for Deontay Baker occasionally. She stated that Robert Butler was sleeping on the living room couch the entire time she was there. Coach was mopping the kitchen, bathroom, and Robert's bedroom floors while she was cleaning the bathroom and bedroom. She told police there was nothing unusual noticed during the cleaning, and she did not notice any bodily fluids, i.e. blood or anything, in the bedroom or in the bathroom. But she did remember seeing a black purse in the bedroom. She left the residence around 1 p.m., and Butler was still sleeping on the couch. According to the police report, Miriam was very nervous, shaking, and crying during most of the questioning. She denied several times about any knowledge related to Taylor McAllister's death at the residence she cleaned up. She did provide police with a buccal swab for DNA, and allowed them to search her black BMW that Deontay Baker drives sometimes. The police found nothing of value in the vehicle for this case.
So she talking about they searched her car?
Yes.
Okay. Now, Detectives Heron and Ragula spoke to Baker again, at which time they asked him to make a controlled phone call to Butler. Now, Butler answered the phone and
What's
began.
A controlled phone call, real quick, just so our people know?
That's where they call them. He's going to pick up the phone. He's going to call while they're listening. And he's going to basically try to get information out of him.
Okay.
Is that right?
Yes.
I mean, that's kind of what you're thinking, right?
Yes.
Because that's what I'm thinking.
Yes. And that's exactly what it was. I just wanted our listeners to know what they meant by a controlled phone call.
Okay. You had me nervous when you asked me because I wasn't sure where you're going with that. But yeah, it's basically they wanted to make a phone call, listen in, and see if he's going to give any information, not knowing that he's basically speaking to the detectives. Now, Butler answered the phone, like I said, and began talking to Baker. Now, during the conversation, Baker told Butler that he needed to tell him what happened to the girl, at which time Butler told him to come to the house and he would tell him. So they make the control phone call. He's not going to give any information
over
the phone.
But Butler wasn't going to tell him over the phone.
No.
He said, come to the house and I'll tell you everything that happened.
Exactly.
After the phone call, Detective Heron, Lieutenant Halstead, and Detective Regula kept talking with Baker. During the conversation, Baker changed his story and told them that Butler had called him up to the house that night. He stated that he and Archer went to the house, at which time Butler told them that Taylor had overdosed. He stated he saw Taylor in Butler's bed and she was obviously out of it. He stated that Archer wanted to call 911, but Butler said no. He stated he got Archer to help him get Taylor to the hospital. Baker stated that Taylor was put in the back seat of Butler's truck and Archer drove the truck. He followed them in the BMW, but Archer started going really fast and he lost sight of the truck. Then Archer called him and said that she was gone. Baker stated that Archer said they couldn't take a dead, naked, white girl to the hospital because they were black, and stated that he called Butler and told him they were going to bring her back to his house, but Butler told them no, under no circumstances, they could not come back to his house. So Baker stated that Archer panicked and took off with Taylor. Baker couldn't get a hold of Archer until after he had left the body in the alley.
So Baker had nothing. He was not part of he knew of it. He knew that Taylor was in the car, but wasn't part of the dumping.
According to this story, yes.
Wasn't part of leaving her on the side of the road or an alley. According to this story.
Yes.
And they're saying that they contacted Butler and Butler said, don't come back to the house, which meant that she was at Butler's house to begin with.
She was in Butler's truck with Archer driving. Now, at some point, she died in the back seat of the truck.
Okay.
Now, Archer called Baker and said, this girl's died in the back of the truck. Now, Archer panicked and took off with Taylor in the back of the truck. Baker is saying that he couldn't get a hold of Archer until after Archer had left the body in the alley. So Baker is saying that Archer took off with the dead body and left her in the alley.
Okay. So Detectives McKinney and Clester made contact with Archer again and transported him back to the station. Now, Archer eventually gave a statement consistent with Baker's statement. So this is leaning a little differently. Archer stated that he was just driving around when he found the alley. He stated that he was alone at this point and pulled Taylor out of the truck and left her there. He stated he then drove the truck back to Butler's house and had his sister, Neosha Johnson, pick him up there. So he's claiming that he was alone, dropped Taylor off in the alley, and then he went back to Butler's house and he had a sister pick him up.
So.
Is that right?
Right.
So I'm just so I've got the timeline because I know it gets confusing and I want to make sure the listeners can understand what's happening here.
So what we know now is that Butler called Baker and Archer to his home to help him deal with Taylor, who was obviously suffering some kind of grave injury or illness. Butler would not allow anyone to call 911 as he did not want the police in his home. And Baker and or Archer take Taylor away from in Butler's truck, meaning to take her to the hospital. But at some point along the journey, Taylor died. And at some point, Taylor ended up in the alley and was found the following morning. And that's where we are now. And that's the conclusion of part one.
I think we're going to stop there. So just, can we do just a quick little recap? So far we have Taylor was at, we know, well, at least to this point, we believe that Taylor was at Butler's house. She was picked up by Archer and Baker. Mm-hmm. And she was taken two separate vehicles. At this point, we believe Archer has taken her and dropped her off in an alley.
Yes.
Okay. Just want to make sure that we'll recap, but we want to make sure we leave our listeners, you know, at a point where they're not just kind of guessing at this.
So that's where we're leaving off for part one. Please join us tomorrow for part two. And again, if you'd like to support the show, please subscribe to our Patreon at patreon.com/Paradise After Dark Podcast.
And check out our Etsy store for some awesome Paradise After Dark gear.
Please make sure to follow us on social media at Paradise After Dark on Instagram and Facebook and at ParadiseDark239 on Twitter. You can also email us at ParadiseAfterDarkPodcast@gmail.com.
You can also check out our website at ParadiseAfterDark.com for our latest episodes, our links to our social media, our Etsy store, and again, our Patreon.
Please make sure to subscribe to the show on whatever platform you're listening and rate and review. This really helps us branch out and reach a wider audience.
And as always, thank you for listening
to Paradise After Dark.
Dark, dark, dark.
What would I do without your smart mouth? Drawing me in and you kicking me out. Got my head spinning, no kidding, I can't pin you down. What's going on in that beautiful mind? I'm on your magical mystery ride, and I'm so dizzy, don't know what hit me. I'll be alright. My head's underwater, but I'm breathing fine. You're crazy and I'm out of my mind. 'Cause all of me loves all of you. Love your curves and all your edges, all your perfect imperfections. Give your all to me, give my all. Drawn me in, you kicking me out. Got my head spinning, no kidding, I can't pin you down. What's going on in that beautiful mind? I'm on your magical mystery ride, and I'm so dizzy, don't know what hit me. I'll be alright. My head's underwater, but you're crazy and I'm out of my mind. 'Cause all of me loves all of you. Love your curves and all your edges, all your perfect imperfections. Give your all to me, give my all to you. You're my end and my beginning, even give you all of me. You give me all of you.
I'm gonna stop there. Thank you.